Do you want to experience beauty and joy and blessing and wonder in your life, but part of you feels like you just don't deserve it? I'm Hannah Mason, and in today's Spark, we're going to explore nourishing your horse. Anyway, if you listen to the previous videos, you'll hear how I talk about how we have these two different parts of ourselves, right? We have the higher consciousness part that has dreams and visions and higher values. And then there's the lower part of ourselves, right? It's the animal. It's the body. It wants to eat and sleep and be comfortable and not be bothered by much of anything, right? And some of us have horses that are regal and feel good about themselves and feel nourished and have fat on their bones and muscles and can do incredible things. And some of us feel kind of like the wimpy weakling in the corner, scrawny, that just didn't get fed enough and doesn't like itself very much and is really scared to even go out there and look at nature because what if there's a fly? We all have these two different aspects of ourselves. But I think most of us go back and forth from feeling like this regal, amazing, worthy person to feeling like the loser in the corner. But the more that we feel like the loser in the corner and the more we feed that part of ourselves, the more that part of ourselves rules the roost. And then we become the rider that's like trampled under the weak horse and it's just like trampled all the time. And so even sometimes when you think of a dream or a vision, that dream or vision gets trampled by that horse that thinks it's totally not deserving of anything or thinks it's not worthy or doesn't want to engage with the world. And so what do? My answer to that is nourish your horse. So what does that mean? It means feed your subconscious mind, because really our bodies are deeply, deeply enmeshed with the subconscious mind, and our bodies just do whatever we've programmed them to do. And our programming all lives in our subconscious mind. So to get a clear idea of what programming is, think of when the first time you ever learned how to ride a bike. You were thinking about holding the handlebars and keeping yourself in balance and do this and do that. And what about the pedal? And what do I do with my right foot? And what do I do with my left foot? And you're like trying to remember all of these different things and hold all of that at once, all in your conscious brain. And I would expect that most of you now know how to ride a bike, carry a conversation, chew gum, and think about what you want to have for dinner all at the same time. Why is that? Because chewing gum has become a subconscious process you don't even pay attention to. But more importantly, riding a bike has become so programmed into you that your subconscious, your body, and the subconscious part of your head literally just take that over. You don't even have to think about it. The riding the bike just happens. That's why people say it's like riding a bike, right? You just get on and you just go and you don't have to think about it. Actually, every single time I get into a car, because we don't own a car, I only drive once in a while. And every time I get into a car, there's a moment where I'm like, what if I forget how to do this? And then I sit down, I hold the wheel, and my body starts driving for me. My body hasn't forgotten how to drive. My conscious mind has forgotten, but my body remembers just fine. So the question is, what do you do when you have programming that's kind of crappy? When you have programming that tells you that you're not worthy and you're not lovable and you're not capable and you're not this, you know what? It's just programming. You can rewrite it. You can rewrite that code. Now, the way the subconscious works, the way it absorbs programming is twofold. One, when you're in a theta state. So a theta state is a state that we're in hypnosis, in that place between sleep and awake, and up to the age of 7, most children, their minds are running in theta all the time. So that's when we're really programmable. So you can put yourself in a self-hypnosis and listen to recordings all the time. I've been doing that. I've been listening at night and sometimes during my naps to a recording where I say all sorts of affirmation things I want to believe about myself. And I just say them over and over and over again. And my brain is just literally getting programmed by them. I'm already feeling a difference of that. The other thing that you can do is actually do real hypnosis. And the other thing you can do is meditate. When you meditate, you can go into a theta state. And you can choose a mantra that is very life-affirming or self-affirming that you say over and over and over again in your mind during that meditation session, and that will also program your mind. The coolest tool, I think, is one that Dave came up with in writing The Size of Your Dreams. So The Size of Your Dreams is a book that the two of us wrote together. It's available here from us here in Israel, or you can get it on Amazon, either in paper or a digital copy. And in The Size of Your Dreams, there's a main character whose name is Kelvin. And Kelvin really struggles with his self-esteem. That becomes really obvious right from the first page, so it's not a spoiler alert. Really struggles with his self-esteem. And it takes him a really, really long time to admit that, even to himself, but particularly to Mr. Griffin, who's his teacher, who actually has the ability to help him. And eventually, don't want to spoil it for everyone, but I'll give you a little bit. Mr. Griffin encourages Kelvin to write an identity card. So in the past videos, I've talked about two different types of cards that Dave came up with based on the teachings of Napoleon Hill for how to help people envision and manifest goals in their lives. So the outcome card has a clear goal with a clear end date. A continual growth card is a card all about an area of your life where you want to continually grow, like health or learning. And the identity card is really quite different from the other two. The identity card is all about who do you want to be and how do you want to see yourself. Now, most of the time, the things that we admire in other people, the qualities that we want to manifest in our lives, they're already there. We're just not seeing them. And by seeing them, first of all, we honor ourselves and we like ourselves a lot more. But also, those qualities in ourselves shine that much more because we're like, oh, I'm generous? Great. And so you just like find yourself becoming more generous because you believe that to be so true about yourself. So I'm going to tell you the identity card process. Step number one, at the top of the card, write, I am. And then you write a whole bunch of different qualities, like generous, for example. And all of these qualities are qualities that you write down based on people you admire. What are the qualities that they have? Ask everyone you know, what are qualities that they see in you? And you could just think of qualities that you wish you had that you feel that you don't. And you write all of those qualities at the top of the card. And then there aren't action steps. This is the action that you do. Get yourself in front of the mirror. This might be intimidating, but I believe in you. Get yourself in front of the mirror and look at yourself straight in the eye. And you say, I'm gonna pretend like it's me, okay? Hannah, I love you. And you say that until you believe it. You really look at yourself in the eye. And I can tell you that in The Size of Your Dreams, Kelvin really struggled with this. And it's the most heart-wrenching and painful part of the book, watching him try to be able to do this simple task of looking himself in the eye and saying, Kelvin, I love you. And then you read the first quality in the card. So you say, I am generous. And then you say, I am so generous that, and you call yourself a nickname. So I could be like, I'm so generous that I am the queen of generosity. And then you come up with at least three examples of how you've been generous. Ideally, every time you read the card, you think of three new examples. But even if you have to repeat those examples, that's fine. And if you do this multiple times a day, at least in the morning and before you go to bed, what's going to happen is you're going to nourish your horse. You're going to be feeding your horse with nourishing words rather than the garbage most of us feed ourselves with. How many times a day do you say, I'm so stupid, or I'm so dumb, or I can never get things right, or I'm so ridiculous? How many times a day do you hear people saying about that about themselves, and that's considered totally socially appropriate? But if someone were to say, I'm awesome, wow, I'm really smart, we would think that they're just being arrogant. And it's like, maybe they're just being kind. And when they put themselves down, they're being cruel. So don't be cruel to yourself. Be kind. Write down an identity card. Do it right now. Do it today. Write down I am and all of these amazing qualities that other people see in you and that when you're honest, you see in yourself and that you see in people that you admire. And get yourself in front of that mirror. Tell yourself you love yourself because you come first and your love matters more than anyone else's love at the end of the day. And if you're struggling with your identity, or you're struggling with your with anxiety, or with your feelings or your emotions or what's going on in your life, and you just can't seem to organize your mind and you feel like you need outside help, I'm here. That's what coaching is for. I'm here to support you. I have time available in my schedule. And as always, I say, my work is 100% money back guaranteed, because I want you to experience fabulous results. In the meantime, I wish all of you a beautiful day.
Want to experience more vibrance, clarity, and joy in your life? Book a guaranteed session at hannahmason.com/joy.